the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You can see many graves there, and one of them is Khadija radiallahu anha's grave. I believe it's near the back of the graveyard. So Khadija radiallahu anha is buried there. Many of the uncles of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are also buried here. We have Qasim, who is buried here as well, the son of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who he had with Khadija radiallahu anha. And we also have Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu is buried here as well. We have some of the sons of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and the daughter Asma bint Abi Bakr, she is buried here. We have Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Bakr is also buried here. And many other companions are buried here in Jannatul Ma'alla. This is the second oldest cemetery in Mecca. There is another cemetery actually outside of our hotel, which maybe if I get a chance, inshallah, I will show everyone. If you look outside of the hotel, I don't know if everyone's room is facing the same direction, but you would, so maybe tonight I will do like a little walking tour. Those of you who want to join me, you can join me, inshallah. I'll send a message on the WhatsApp group, and we can visit this place. It's called Maqbara al-Shubayka. It's right outside our hotel. Okay, coming up here on the right-hand side is Masjid Jinn. Masjid Jinn, this is where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he recited Quran to the jinn. Allah Azza wa Jal, he talks about this in the Quran as well. And he gave da'wah to the jinn here. And he went with Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. This on your right here, this is Masjid Jinn. So it was in this vicinity that he gave da'wah to the jinn. And Allah Azza wa Jal talks about this in the Quran. The night of the 8th of Dhul-Hijjah. The 9th of Dhul-Hijjah, they'll go to Arafah, and then they're going to spend the night on the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah in Muzdalifah, and then on the 10th, they'll come back to Mina, and they're going to spend 10, 11, and 12 in Mina. And during these days, they will the main action that they will do is the stoning of the three Jamarat, which we'll show you when we pass by, inshallah. Mina is called Mina because the word Mina means the flowing of blood, and the reason why it's called Mina is because this is where the sacrifice of the animals take place as well. So it's in order to reflect that. Mina also houses a place called Masjid al-Bay'ah. Masjid al-Bay'ah is where the Pledge of Allegiance took place with the people of Medina. So as I mentioned earlier, when we went to the Cave of Thawr, or the Mount of Thawr, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to meet the tribes during the season of Hajj in order to establish a state and a home for the Muslims, because Mecca was becoming unbearable. So he met many tribes, and most of the tribes, they rejected his message. However, the tribe of the Ansar, the tribe of Khazraj in particular, Khazraj and Aus, but it was the Khazraj first. Khazraj and Aus tribes that were residing in Medina, they make up the Ansar. They were the ones that accepted Islam, and they pledged allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is known as Bay'atul Aqadah al-Ula. So there were two pledge of allegiances. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met them first, there was only six of them from the Khazraj tribe. They accepted Islam, they went back to their people, and they gave da'wah to their people, they accepted Islam. And then the following year, they came with 12 individuals, and they pledge allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is on the right hand side. On the right hand side, over here, this area, on the right hand side, this is where it is said that Abraha and his army got destroyed. Abraha, who was the governor of Yemen, this is before the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made an intention to destroy the Kaaba. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he sent small birds, flocks of birds which had pebbles in their beaks, and through those pebbles Allah Azza wa Jal destroyed Abraha and his army of elephants. And this is what Allah Azza wa Jal talks about in Surah Fil. Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi ashabil fil. Allah Azza wa Jal talks about this story, and it is said that this happened in this vicinity. So coming back to Bay'atul Aqaba, so the first pledge of allegiance took place. Then on the following year, so this is the 13th year after the prophethood, after the revelation, 13th year after the revelation, the tribes of Aus and Khazraj, they first pledge of allegiance, again they went back to their people, and more people started accepting Islam. And bear in mind, these people have not met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Among the first people that accepted Islam, you had As'ad ibn Zurarah, you had Jabir ibn Abdullah. These were people who were the first to accept Islam from the people of Medina. They went back, they told people about Islam. Now the people of Medina haven't yet met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the following year, a group of 73 men and 2 women came to Hajj, obviously to fulfill the rites of Hajj, but they also came to give a second pledge of allegiance. And this is known as Bay'atul Aqaba al-Thaniya. And they gave a second pledge of allegiance, and that pledge of allegiance was basically that they're not going to associate any partners with Allah, that they're not going to commit kufr, they're not going to steal, they're not going to commit zina, they're not going to kill their children, and so on and so forth. This basically showed their commitment, and it was after these two pledges of allegiance that they invited the Muslims to migrate to Medina. And this is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded people to start migrating to Medina. And we're going to talk about the migration inshallah when we are going to Medina. So all this now we see, you have Masjid al-Khayf coming up, which is the main masjid in Mina. Now you'll be able to see loads of tents, and these are where the Hujjaj, they reside. People usually get lost here quite a lot as well, because everything looks the same. And this is also where the 3 Jamarat are, where the stoning take place. Now, a common misconception, people actually think that Shaitan is standing there, which is why people get overly emotional and they start throwing slippers and all sorts, and because they actually think that Shaitan is there. And there's a chance for us to get out back, to get back at Shaitan. But this is not actually the case. As in, the stoning of the 3 Jamarat is symbolic to basically show our enmity towards Shaitan. So you can see on the left-hand side, Masjid al-Khayf on the left-hand side. And you can see all of the tents around as well. Masjid al-Khayf is the main masjid. This is where many people will come. They will perform the salah here. But it's a huge, huge place, and you can imagine that during the days of Hajj, this area is extremely busy. And on the left-hand side, if you see those 3 bridges, that structure on the left-hand side, that is where the Jamarat are. And this is where the Hujjaj will go. You can see that bridge leading up to that structure. That bridge is usually full with Hujjaj going there to stone the 3 Jamarat on the 10th, 11th and 12th. So why used to come to this particular mountain is because this cave, the cave of Hira, is the only cave in Mecca where it is facing the Qibla. And actually through this cave you can see the Kaaba. Maybe it might be a bit difficult right now because of the construction work. Back then, when there were no buildings, etc., the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could see the Kaaba from the cave of Hira. And I actually entered the cave of Hira yesterday, and you could see the Haram from a little gap. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would come here, and one day when he was in this cave, he used to meditate, he used to contemplate over the creation of Allah. And in this state, Jibreel alayhi salam came, and he told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to recite. He said, "Iqra." So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he responded, he said, "Ma ana biqari," that I cannot recite, or I am unable to recite. And the reason why he said that is because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was illiterate, he was uneducated, and this was actually there was a wisdom behind that. Because if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could read and write, then people would say that he has written the Quran himself. However, he was illiterate, so this accusation could not be made. So then again, Jibreel alayhi salam, he told the Prophet Surah Alaq, "Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, khalaqa al-insana min alaq, iqra wa rabbuka al-akram, alladhi allama bil qalam, allama al-insana ma lam ya'lam." These verses were revealed in the cave of Hira. And after he received these verses, he climbed down the mountain, and he went to Khadija radiallahu anha. He was shaken because he didn't understand what just happened. Jibreel alayhi salam came to him in the form of a human being. He was really random because he's never seen Jibreel alayhi salam before. So this was very frightening for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was trembling out of this fear. He rushed down this mountain and he went to Khadija radiallahu anha, and he told Khadija radiallahu anha of what happened.
And Khadija radiallahu anha comforted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, shrouded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and informed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Allah azza wa jal will not abandon you. Allah azza wa jal, whatever's happened is going to be good for you, because you are a good person. And she mentioned certain qualities of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that innaka latasilu rahim wa tuqdi al-dayf, that you, verily you maintain ties of kinship, you look after your host, you look after your neighbors. He mentioned all of this, she mentioned all of this to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this happened in this cave, and these were the first verses that were revealed. After this, the Prophethood started from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Quran started being, was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bit by bit. However, one interesting thing is that after these verses were revealed, there was a gap where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not receive any verses, according to one opinion, for 2 weeks. 2 weeks he did receive no revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he got scared, and he was upset as to why he's not receiving any verses from Allah. And all sorts of thoughts were going through his mind. Maybe he was thinking that maybe Allah Azza wa Jalla is not pleased with me, which is why he's not revealing anything to me. But then after 2 weeks, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he revealed verses of the Quran, such as Ya ayyuhal muzammil, Ya ayyuhal muddathir, where Allah addresses the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, oh the shrouded one, oh the one who has wrapped himself. And the reason why Allah addressed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that manner is because when you came down the mountain and you went to Khadija, he told Khadija radiallahu anha, Zambiluni, Zambiluni, Taghfiruni, Taghfiruni, that oh Khadija, shroud me and cover me. So this is why Allah Azza wa Jal addressed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with Ya ayyuhal muzammil and Ya ayyuhal muddathir. So these were the verses that were revealed after this period of a 2 week gap. Also Allah Azza wa Jal revealed Surah Qalam, the first verse of Surah Qalam, Noon wal Qalam wa ma yasturun. Allah Azza wa Jal revealed Wa Duha wa Layli Idha Saja. These surahs were revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the first 5 verses of Surah Alaq were revealed in the cave of Hira.